Hi, I'm Kenshi Takayama. I'm happy to present my work titled Compatible Intrinsic Triangulations. This was done while I was at National Institute of Informatics. Currently, I'm working at CyberAgent. This work is about intersurface mapping, which is about finding correspondences between points on surfaces of the same genus. There are three key properties that we want to have in such maps: continuity, bijectivity, and low distortion. Maps that have the first two properties are called homeomorphisms, and we specifically target this type of maps. Such maps are useful for transferring various kinds of data on surfaces, such as texture, displacement, tessellation, and so on. And in general, they are difficult to compute. There is a vast literature on computing maps between surfaces, and many methods have been proposed, including non-rigid registration methods, projection-based methods, and distribution-based methods, such as functional maps. All these have their own merits and applications, but ultimately, these maps are defined on vertices only, and it's not clear at all how to map points on edges or points inside faces to the other surface. So it's hard to get homeomorphisms using these methods. There is, of course, a literature on surface homeomorphisms, and all previous methods use some form of intermediate domains, such as plane, sphere, hyperbolic plane, or base complex. These are all technically sound, but they tend to make the algorithm quite a bit complicated. In particular, global and end-to-end distortion minimization becomes challenging in this context. And there are only three papers so far that address this issue. The two on the right can handle disk topology surfaces only, and the one on the left can handle closed surfaces of arbitrary topology, so it is considered the current state of the art. That said, our contribution is a simpler and more intuitive alternative to the state of the art. In particular, our method does not involve any intermediate domains. The key to our method is the use of the intrinsic triangulations technique. Its original aim was to solve PDEs on surfaces robustly. We show its new usage for the problem of intersurface mapping. Before moving on, I just want to be honest and make it clear. Our method does not offer any practical advantage over the state of the art. Our method is designed purely empirically and is less robust than the state of the art. The main point of this work is to stimulate research in this field by providing a new perspective and also releasing the source code so that others can build on top of it. Okay, here's a quick recap of the intrinsic triangulations technique. We always start with an extrinsic triangulation, which is just an ordinary triangular mesh. From here, we can apply some local operations. The first basic operation is intrinsic edge flip. For example, if you are to flip this edge, we take its two adjacent triangles and flatten them to 2D. Then we flip the edge in 2D and obtain new triangle shapes. These triangles are then mapped back to the surface in 3D. They get bent across the edges of the original mesh, but we don't care as long as they can be flattened to 2D isometrically. Another basic operation is vertex insertion. For example, if we are to insert a vertex to this triangle, we first flatten it to 2D, then insert the vertex in 2D, splitting the triangle into three. These new triangles are then mapped back to the surface in 3D. Through these local operations, we can get infinitely many different tessellations over the same surface geometry defined by the original triangular mesh. Another source of our inspiration is the concept of compatible triangulations in 2D, which was used for shape interpolation. In this example, a solid shape on the left and a target shape on the right are interpolated using a compatible triangulation. Here, every face is in one-to-one correspondence as highlighted by colors in some faces. So this trivially defines a homeomorphism between two 2D shapes. So our question is, Can we do the same on 3D surfaces using intrinsic triangulations? And the answer is yes, we can. So here comes our method called compatible intrinsic triangulations. First of all, we are given a pair of triangle meshes of the same genus, A and B. In addition to these, we take as input something called vertex images. It's simply an assignment to each vertex of A, a position on the surface B expressed using barycentric coordinates. We take another vertex image in the opposite direction as well. Importantly, we assume that these vertex images are of some good quality. They must not be some random inconsistent assignments, otherwise our algorithm will fail. And they can be generated using any of the existing methods. Specifically, we use these in our work. Our output is a compatible intrinsic triangulation, or a CIT in short. It's an intrinsic triangulation on each of A and B, and it is constructed in such a way that every face is in one-to-one correspondence. Here I highlight some corresponding faces around vertex 1 rings. So this is our new way of defining homeomorphisms between surfaces. So how do we generate it? Our algorithm mainly consists of 4 steps. The first step is vertex insertion, which is very simple. According to the input vertex image, we simply insert A's vertex to B one by one, splitting triangles into 3. And we end up with something like this. We do the same in the opposite direction as well. Now I'd like to introduce the notion of compatible edges. First of all, recall that every vertex is already in one-to-one correspondence by definition. So we assign random colors to corresponding vertices. Then let's look at edges. For example, this edge on A connects these two vertices. If we look for the same pair of vertices in B, we see that there is an edge connecting them. So we call this edge compatible and assign a random color to it representing its ID. Okay, now let's look at this edge. If you look for the same pair of vertices in B, we see that there is no edge connecting them, so we call this edge incompatible and show it in black. Using this edge coloring scheme, we see that after the vertex insertion step, most edges are incompatible. Our goal then is to make all the edges compatible. If we succeed in doing so, all the faces become compatible and we get a homeomorphism. The step 2 of our algorithm is Delaunay flipping, which was originally proposed by Sharp et al. And this is done separately for each of A and B, so we can forget about all the colors for now. The idea is very simple. For every edge, we look at its two opposite corners and sum their angles. If it's larger than pi, we flip the edge intrinsically. We repeat this until there are no more edges to flip. This process is known to converge in finite steps. And we end up with something like this. We do the same on the other surface as well. Now, if we check for the edge compatibility, we see that most edges are already compatible at this point. This is thanks to our assumption that the input vertex images are of some good quality. Our remaining task then is to fix these sparsely distributed incompatible edges one by one. Our step 3 is an algorithm called flip to compatible, which consists of a few subroutines. The first subroutine is shown here, which is very simple. For this incompatible edge, clearly flipping it will make it compatible. Here's another subroutine, which is also simple. For these two incompatible edges, flipping them simultaneously will make them compatible. There are 3 more subroutines, and please refer to the paper for more details. We repeat applying these subroutines until no more changes are made. Our step 4 is resolution of incompatible patches. An incompatible patch is a connected set of non-compatible faces with a compatible boundary. Here's an example. On A and B, the two triangles adjacent to these incompatible edges form incompatible patches because their boundaries are compatible. Our basic strategy is to merge some vertices to make the patches compatible. We perform a simple pattern matching to determine which vertices to merge. We design 5 such patterns as detailed in the paper. Lastly, I briefly mention our mapped optimization algorithm. We adopt the same modified Newton scheme as in the previous work. We use the same symmetric Dirichlet energy as the measure of distortion. This can be trivially computed once we have a CIT. For each intrinsic face, we know its 2D triangle shape on A and B. So we get a 2x2 Jacobian matrix mapping one triangle to the other in some 2D coordinate frame. We just adapt its Frobenius norm squared, weighted by the triangle area. We compute the energies gradient and Hessian using automatic differentiation. We then solve for the descent direction, followed by a line search. At every search step, we generate a CIT with the new vertex images. Now comes the evaluation part. We ran our algorithm on the dataset released by the previous work, and we achieved similar or slightly better energy for all but two cases. These two exceptional cases are highly non-isometric, and our algorithm easily got stuck in local minima. To assess the practicality of our method, we did a robustness test on the Princeton dataset. It consists of 19 categories, and we randomly picked 5 pairs per category, totaling in 95 pairs to test. Out of these, HOT, the method we used to generate the input vertex images, failed on 7 cases no matter how we chose the landmarks. So we tested our method against the remaining 88 pairs. Out of these, our method succeeded in 81 pairs, meaning a success rate of 92%. Here are some samples of our test results. We can visually confirm that our optimization does indeed reduce the mapping distortion, as indicated by the smoother checkerboard patterns on the right. Our work has a number of limitations and future directions to explore. First, our algorithm is purely empirically designed with no guarantee of success, and it sometimes fails. In this failure example, the initial vertex images are very strongly distorted, resulting in large clusters of numerous incompatible edges, which our algorithm could not get rid of. We believe more thorough analysis of our problem setting is crucial, and we hope to get some kind of theoretical guarantee. Another issue is that our algorithm is quite prone to getting stuck in local minima. To improve this, we would like to find a way of smoothing out the mapping distortion more effectively, perhaps by mimicking the metric regularization technique used in the previous work. Lastly, our method is very slow on large meshes. A multi-resolution approach is a natural direction to explore, and perhaps a recent technique of bijective projection in a shell by Jiang et al. Could be utilized. This concludes my talk. Thank you for your attention. The source code is available in the URL shown below.